and good evening. Welcome to Voice of the Province. I'm your host, Troy Glover. Today we have Blaine Higgs, leader of the New Brunswick opposition, to talk to us about property tax assessments in the province. Thanks for being with us today, Mr. Higgs.
Thanks for having me, Troy.
Now, earlier today, you called for the Premier of New Brunswick, Brian Gallant, to resign. Why?
I did. This process has been going on now for over a month. As assessments started to roll out, tax bills started to roll out, we saw we're getting more and more calls from individual people and property owners and homeowners. And as it started to ramp up and it came in, it became, well, this is becoming a big issue. So we asked questions about it in the opening of the legislature back in March, early March, mid-March. And we basically said, you know, what's happening here? We're getting all of these complaints, and so what's happening with the property tax system? And of course, basically, we didn't get any answers from anyone. We probably asked 60 questions. And if you recall back in mid-March, the Minister of Service of Brunswick put out, there are a few errors in the system, you know, but we were dealing with that. So we continued to ask questions because we continue to get this information directly from homeowners about massive increases, you know, 20, 30, 40, 50%, some 100%. I mean, emails that were saying, you know, our property, we didn't do anything to our property. So we kept asking questions. So we said, and we got an answer back that maybe there's 2,000 problems, but we're dealing with that. Then it still went on, but no problems. Deflect. We got questions that were not answered, but deflected. We got, you know, I got personal attacks on myself. We had all kinds of red herrings thrown out there to try to deflect the discussion, but never any answers. So then, just before the legislature arises, we ended up with, an email that came to a reporter here in the city, and basically said that this is a problem that's been created by fast-tracking a new system. So then the premier says, I just found out about that. Well, we've been asking questions for 3-4 weeks, all the while the legislature was open. We got zero answers. The Minister of Service to Brunswick didn't answer one question, didn't even attempt to. The Minister of Environment and Local Government stood up and talked about many things, but no answers. And then to say that all of a sudden, we see now we have a problem with fast-tracking. Well, what we found out is that this problem was well known in the Premier's office. It was well known that the problem was fast-tracking and that the errors and the fraudulent bills that were being sent out were not legitimate in the sense of an accurate calculation. But it wasn't reported. It wasn't talked about. It wasn't presented. The information wasn't put forward. So the Premier's been trying to cover this up for a month and hoping when the legislative session ended that it would go away. Well, it hasn't gone away because property owners, rightfully so, are really upset. They're ticked, and they should be, because this is a fabricated tax bill that has gone out with a system that was implemented without being properly quality control checked. And that's not the fault of the assessors and the people in Service New Brunswick. That's the fault of the Premier and the Premier's office ordering a fast track on a system to get taxpayers' dollars into the coffers. And we learned just today another piece of news about $5.7 million of new revenue was anticipated. All of this information has dripped out. But mind you, it was always there. And all the Premier had to do a month ago was say, look, we tried to put a new system in place. We realized that it isn't working out. We had a lot of errors. You know, we're going to go back to the 2016 assessments and avoid all this confusion to the motion to property owners because it's the right thing to do. But instead, try to cover it up for a month and hope it goes away.
Now, you mentioned fast track. Could you explain me exactly what fast tracking is?
Sure. Well, in a system that's this complicated, it basically is an aerial photography system that goes over properties and kind of assess whether the properties had any changes from the last time. It was suggested in the rollout of this program that it would take 3 to 4 years in order to implement, because you do the property surveillance and then you send assessors out to the property to do a physical check, and then they make changes to the property assessment based on what the reality is, but they also make changes based on how the program works. As an example, I understand that the aerial flights would calculate the eaves, so a roof line, as the full size of the square footage of the house. Well, we know that the eaves overhang, you know, a foot or 2 feet, and so in that case, that's not the square footage of the house. But those type of things would be fact-checked by an assessor going on site. And anyone in the assessment office who's used to doing that would do that, and they do it in a pilot. So they wouldn't do it with every house. I understand now what's just leaked out in the last week, that instead of 2,000 issues, we think that there could be as many as 100,000 homes impacted. And now this has got a lot broader. And all it had to have was a pilot program, do a few houses, have the aerophotography done, and then do the fact check by going and doing the site visit. And you would gradually get the program to work better and better and more accurate. But no, there was a fast track that went from 3 to 4 years to 9 to 12 months. And quality checks had no time to be done. And this isn't a decision that would have been made by the employees and the assessors in the assessment office. It would have been made at a high levels in Service New Brunswick, at a high levels in the government. This is not an assessment problem. This is a political problem.
So now, if the approval to proceed came from the Premier's office, do you think you should take full responsibility for this?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Where else would it go? I mean, what was the first reaction? To blame the assessment folks, to blame the individuals in Service NB who are dealing with assessments. Now, that's not the first time this Premier has tried to blame someone else. You know, the one key factor in leadership is take ownership. And there are problems that you may say, well, I didn't know about this. Well, you should have known about it. But in this scenario, the trail follows right back to the Premier's office. He, in fact, did know about it. And he knew that there was a fast track program underway, and yet proceeded anyway because need more money in the coffers.
Okay, we're gonna go to our first call for the evening. Bill from Nakawit. Hello, Bill. Bo from Nakawit.
Yeah, Bo. My name is Bo. Okay, and you know the question is, should Premier Gallant resign because of this? Well, he should, but you know what? The way things are in politics. He won't, and he's not going to. If anything should realistically happen, the cabinet minister for that department, I believe it's Ed Doherty, he should be the one gone for sure. But all I want to say, guys, is you know, Blaine Higgs, I wish you the best of luck as opposition leader. You seem like a really, really good down-to-earth guy, and I like you, and I like you as a finance minister under Dave Allward. You're really good. So I wish you the best of luck as opposition leader. But I think what should happen in New Brunswick is I think the PC party should the PCs have become just like the Liberals, and it's happened since the 1970s, continued through the 80s, and nowadays there's no difference between the PC party and the Liberal Party of New Brunswick. They're one and the same. So I think we should have a big change in New Brunswick. I support People's Alliance and Chris Austin in the province because they're the party that is the real difference. And that's all I wanted to say.
Well, thank you, Bo, for your call. I guess in just the response, if you're still on the line, basically, you know, when I decided to go for the leadership role, I saw how many opportunities we have in this province to do a better job. I ran on the philosophy that the one thing that had to change was politics. I ran that politics is the single biggest barrier to success in this province. Now, I think you can see some visible changes within the office. And basically, if you look at the case where Dominic Carty has joined in our office, we are doing politics differently because in order for New Brunswick to prosper, we must. The lines across party lines have to be blurred. We have to get a situation where we are now focused on doing the right things for the province. It goes beyond party politics because we must. Our province is in trouble, and I've seen it firsthand that the status quo won't work. Unfortunately, I guess we disagree on parties. I believe our party can change, and it's the only reason I'm here.
Do you feel that New Brunswickers have lost confidence in the office of the Premier over this?
I do, and they should have. Because it's not a case of, you know, mistakes can be made. It's a case of the cover-up afterwards. You know, even going back, you know, years ago in the U.S. when Nixon was impeached, I mean, it wasn't so much the Watergate scenario. It was the fact that he tried to cover it up through the whole thing. So you say, well, this isn't as significant as that. Well, it is to 100,000 property owners who have seen their assessments for no valid reason of any kind, just completely unreasonable. But the point is what it illustrates. It illustrates that the credibility is lost, the integrity is lost, the fact that you blame someone else for an issue that you have created by forcing a project to move forward in a fashion that was unacceptable. And so when you don't take responsibility and say, well, all right, we shouldn't have done it this fast, this is what we're going to do to correct it. We fought hard, long and hard to get the appeals extended. And finally, after enough information came out, they extended the appeal date to August. But it should be just forget about this, go back to the assessments of 2016 and let's move forward. But the Premier's definitely lost credibility. When you lose credibility, you lose the ability and the opportunity to lead, and you should.
So are you saying that it's a much more accepting environment if politicians just come out and say, we messed up, we'll try to fix this?
Absolutely. I mean, we all have situations and we all make mistakes. And I've yet to meet the person that does not make mistakes. But you take ownership for them. You don't blame somebody else. You don't try to find someone else that to take the blame for something that you yourself have created. And this trail has led right to the Premier's office, despite all of the deflections and non-answers and all of the debate that went in the legislature, but none of it reflecting on the real facts until the email came forward that said, here's what's happened. And when that email came forward, do you imagine the courage that it took from an individual to say, you know, this is just wrong. It's not only wrong to be blaming people when they're not at fault, but it's wrong not to take responsibility for what you do. I would like to know, from the Premier, I mean, who gave the order to fast track? And we've seen emails come out today that's pretty convincing that it came from the Premier's office. And so at some point, all right, who gave the order? Well, it appears it came from the Premier's office. Nothing should be happening in the Premier's office without the Premier himself knowing. In the case of who benefited from this? Was it purely to get more money in the system? Were there incentives being paid for fast tracking? I mean, how did this work? So this information just isn't surfacing, and it just is coming out in drips as the Premier and the office are forced to be accountable to the public.
So do you think in this case, whoever sent out the email, the whistleblower, in many words, do you think they would see any repercussions for what they've done for people trying to keep their jobs safe?
No one should ever receive repercussions for doing the right thing. To be honest and forthright, and this is wrong. They are civil servants. They are working for the province of New Brunswick. You know, I remember being in government and often having conversations around who do we work for? They say, well, we work for the government. No, you don't work for the government. You work for the province of New Brunswick. We all do. They're the people we're accountable to. So if you see the citizens of the province being impacted through fraudulent assessment bills, and you have no ability to deal with it, and then the Premier comes out and blames you for it, what do you do? Do you say, do I just accept this? I know what happened. Doing the right thing and doing the courageous thing is commendable, and we need to encourage more of that to get this province in back on track.
Would you say that it's possible for a minister to be aware of everyone? I'm sorry for that. For a minister to be aware for everything that their team is doing, would you say it's possible for a minister?
You know, it's difficult. I appreciate that. But this is not a little thing. This is a big thing. This is a major shift in how property assessments are done. This is a shift that basically is fundamental to the process. And so in that scenario, the minister, the Premier's office, the chief of staff, the Premier himself, they would all know about this because it would be presented through the system. It would be presented to the minister. The deputy minister would present it to the cabinet or the Service New Brunswick folks would present at senior levels. It all would go through the system because it is a big step change in how it's been done in the past.
Now, the Premier has argued that you've called for his resignation several times in the past few weeks. What would you say makes this call different from those others?
You know, it's kind of a series of events this past month. where there has been a continual progression of information that only came out because it came out in another direction than the Premier's office. There's been a series of admissions that only came out after the information was put forward that, wow, I have nowhere else to turn, so now I've got to admit that, yes, this is bigger than that. Yes, it was fast-tracked. And yes, I guess I did know about it. But who else can I blame along this process? The problem is that the deception that went on from the early March right through until the legislative session ended, that is the problem. The Premier did not own up, did not come clean, and now is playing cover-up big time. And that's my challenge, is that that is not acceptable. I wrote an article back in January of 2016, and it was called The Art of Deception. And it basically highlighted four or five different issues with this government that basically tell half-truths and make people believe one thing when the rest of the facts would tell quite a different story. But that's been a signature, a trademark of this government. Well, this tops it all because of the direct and forceful and manipulative process in trying to avoid the truth.
Could you give me examples of these what you've said are half-truths with this current government?
Well, let's give an example of the strategic review program. So that program was spent about a year doing that program. Everything that came out of that review was information that I had met with the government about a month, 2 months after we lost the election, and went through all of these things because we did a government renewal. We did the same thing. And all of that information was there. And it was all there, and the thing that was different is that they said we're going to name bridges and buildings. We didn't have that one. But the rest of the stuff was in there. So why did they spend a year going around duplicating exactly what we had done 3 years prior and had the information? And I shared it all. Because they wanted to justify an HST increase. So they basically did this situation, said, we're going to go around, we're going to convince the public.
Sorry, I'm going to have to cut you off right there because we have to quickly go to break.
Okay.
Continue with us as we continue to talk to Blaine Higgs about provincial property tax assessments. To Voice of the Province. I'm your host, Troy Glover. Today we're talking to the opposition leader for New Brunswick, Blaine Higgs. Let's continue on, or I'd like you to continue on from before I cut you off from before we went to break, explaining about half-truths in the government.
So going back, I was talking about the strategic review program. And so after a year-long travel around the province with the sole focus of raising the HST, so remember, as it wound down at the end, it was like, well, do you prefer deep cuts in health or deep cuts in education or raise the HST? When the fact that neither was required, because all that they were funding was their extensive spending model. Their spending has gone up to the tune of around 800 to 900 million a year more at this point in time. So they had to find a way to find money to cover their new spending. We didn't need to make deep cuts in anything, and we didn't need the HST either. But when you're going to build great big highways that you don't need, when you're going to build bridges you don't need, and when you're going to buy shipyards you don't need, when you're going to throw money at Sears and say, well, we'll hope you can find a job there somewhere, when you're going to buy jobs and make it look like economic development, then you need to tax people in order to pay for it. So we've had over 700 million of new taxes. We've had around 900 million of new spending, and our deficit is 200 million. And that's all with the HST, and now they're hoping to bring the carbon tax on, and they're hoping to get tax on marijuana. I mean, this government is like a government gone wild. How much money can we spend? How much more can we tax you in order to buy your vote?
Going back to our conversation talking about the person that leaked out the information that there was something seriously wrong with the property tax assessments, do you think there's anyone else out there, like in this case someone came forward, but do you believe that within the current government there's anything else that people probably aren't talking about or aren't bringing to the public's eye?
In relation to property tax or outside of that?
Outside of that.
Absolutely. Probably. I do, and everywhere. And I think it's a case that, you have long-term people in the system that know what it's going to take to fix the province. And they know that they can be better, but they don't dare be better. Because the first thing that happens if you put your head up is another government comes along and you're fired because you worked with the previous government. I mean, I saw it. I saw it firsthand. I saw good people fired for no other reason. Just the fact that they worked with the last government. Good people that were not part of a hiring program of the previous government in case of, I think of long-term civil servants. So why would you dare put your head up? Why would you dare get engaged in fixing the province and putting forward what you believe in? What you put forward is what you actually think the government will support. That's why it is so courageous of this person or persons who have come forward and said, this is wrong. We're being blamed for something that we did not create. We're the front line. We're going to be out there actually the ones meeting these people and doing the assessments that are seeing people on the door. And guess what kind of reception that they get? It's not the premier knocking on doors that had their assessment up by 50%. So, people, we need people to come forward. We can fix this, but people have to be brave and we need to find ways to protect them so that they can do what's right.
So you're saying that anyone that comes forward about any misdealings within the government should be praised and protected?
Absolutely, absolutely. It'll hold the government accountable for what they do, and it holds us all to a higher account, no matter what party is in power. And there has to be a mechanism there. They can't be, frivolous claims and such. You have to have some basis for how it comes forward. But it has to be such that people feel you can have an open and honest discussion without the fear of repercussion.
We're going to go to the phones again. We have Jean from McDuckdick. Hello, Jean.
Hello. Hello.
Hello. Hello, Jean.
Yes.
Good evening.
Okay. Yeah, good evening, Blaine. I'd like to have a question for you, Blaine. If you could answer it for me, to get some information from the Premier. From what I understand, he has mentioned opening another office to duplicate what Service New Brunswick is already being paid to do if they were left alone to do their job.
That's correct.
Now, what I would like to know is who, in a bankrupt or pretty well bankrupt province, who is going to pay for this other job, other office, the staffing of it, and whatnot?
Okay, well, basically what the Premier's saying is that we need to privatize, essentially, the Service New Brunswick Assessment Branch and take it out of the hands of the government. I mean, it was only back at the beginning, I think in October of 2015, where the Service New Brunswick was made a Crown Corporation. But basically, Gene, all that this is doing, and because this is trying to make the public look like they're doing something, it basically putting the jobs of the Service New Brunswick folks at risk by privatizing this, when that is not the problem. It is not the issue with Service New Brunswick and the folks at the assessment office or at those levels. The problem is that the political decision has disrupted the program so badly that they were not able to do their job. This is not going to be solved by moving it into a private sector, other than if you can hold the political abuse at bay. The situation is in the Premier's office. The situation of changing the assessment office through what he's suggesting is purely to make people think that he's doing something. This commission that's being put forward, the credentials of the individual, Judge Robertson notwithstanding, is going to be an internal investigation. Go on for 2, 3, 4, 5 months, come out sometime in the summer, and guess what? Before it ever meets the light of day, it'll get a lot of scrutiny. And it'll be, oh, we've done this, we've done that. If we just let the reporters finish the investigation, go and spend an afternoon or morning with Service New Brunswick folks, this would surface real fast, how this came about, what the problem is, and it's not with the assessment office.
No, from what I understand, the assessment office was doing their job as they were instructed by Gallant.
That's what we understand as well. And the more information that comes forward, the deeper the Premier's office gets. And the sad part about all this is, as he's been trying to cover it up now for a month.
And he, it sounds like, but he talks about opening another office or putting it in someone else's hands. We still have Service New Brunswick.
Oh, no, we would have a section of it, but the assessment office would be different. So the employees in Service New Brunswick in the assessment office would be at risk. And it's not their fault. I mean, this is no different than the first statement we heard from the Premier was, oh, well, it's somebody in Service New Brunswick, it's their fault. You know, so the first words that come out are it's somebody else's fault. I don't, you know, the Premier wouldn't take responsibility for it.
Okay. Moving back to calls for resignation, how far deep would you say that resignation should go to cleanse, would you say, the palate of New Brunswickers sourced on the issue?
Well, I feel that given the severity of the situation, the severity of the cover-up and the whole fabrication of assessment and the bills that associate tax bills, you know, we've seen a chain of events here that ties more and more people, but it gets right to the Premier's office. So I expect that we're going to see a scapegoat through this process. You know, could be someone at senior levels in Service New Brunswick, could be, you know, the Minister of Service New Brunswick, could be Chief of Staff, should be the Premier. But likely there will be an appeasement made and they'll hold off as long as possible so that the citizens of the province say, well, okay, well, they dealt with it. Well, you know, if it's not dealt with at the most senior level, it's dealt with as a more or less a way to appease people. And this commission, you know, you can say, well, maybe it should be a public inquiry. There's talk about that because to get more independence. The sad part is this isn't a difficult process to evaluate. This isn't hard to figure out what happened. And we don't need to spend months and millions of dollars in doing that. But you do need some people in there that are looking for the truth. And the people that and having the free rein to look for the truth. But if you tie the hands of the individual in charge of the commission, because it's an internal process, it goes through government and then comes out, it's very suspect. And the mandate can be restricted such that you don't look at certain things. You only can look at this box. You can't look at the box over in the corner. And that's the problem. You need to have an open-end discussion with the individuals in the system that have the freedom to speak about what they know has been the problem.
Okay. We're going to go back to the lines again. On the line, we have Charles from Fredericton. Hello, Charles.
Bonsoir, Troy. Bonsoir, Blaine.
Bonsoir, Charles.
Comment ça va?
Très bien, très bien. Et tu?
Hey, your French is getting better, much better. Next time I can speak le chiac. maybe one day Blaine and me, we will sit down. I've been trying to hunt this guy down for the past few months, but one of these days. Listen, I think what's going to happen here is I think the minister is going to resign, and the deputy minister must take responsibility for what happened here. But what's bugging me, and maybe if you could answer this question, how come property tax, the Tim Horton in St. John on Bayside pays $38,000 property tax a year, while the cargo across the street where they load the crude oil, they only pay $19,000. Can you explain to me that one?
Well, no, I can't, Charles. You know more about the actual bill than I do. However, I think that we should do a comparison across this province and compare with other industries across the country and ensure that the taxes being paid here by our industries and businesses and properties are fair and equitable and can be justified. I think that's probably a project long overdue, and I'd like to see it happen.
Do you think the Irvings are paying their fair share?
They should indeed pay their fair share. And if we find otherwise, I am sure that the right thing to do would be done and we would fix it because I'm all for making it a fair and equitable and very transparent system.
Because I hope the system goes, oh my God, I'm taking over here. I'm very sorry. I just hope that this this issue takes takes control of his own, because something like this in France would have caused a revolution. But, you know, people are just lay back and watch. And watching, we will do. You guys have a good night.
Thank you, Charles. Thanks for your call.
Now, also on the line, we have Arlene from St. John. Hello, Arlene.
Hi, how are you this evening?
Hello, Arlene. I'm fine. Yourself?
Great, thank you. Just a couple of comments, actually. This has nothing to do with Service New Brunswick. I think that we're pointing the finger in the wrong direction here. And as Mr. Higgs alluded to, we need to make sure that the opposition party does something about this. This is not even about setting up a commission. I mean, think about what the Liberals are doing at the current time. And then we're going to allow them to set up a commission to look into these so-called issues. They've already done us a great injustice. Where's the system of checks and balances? I think the opposition needs to step up to the plate here. They need to do something. So, Mr. Higgs, my question to you tonight is this. Will you follow through with respect to this issue to make sure that this government is accountable to the people who actually put them in place?
Well, Arlene, I guess I'm disappointed that you haven't seen the activity that's been going on in the legislature for 3 months. Or three weeks, sorry, when the ledge was open. Every day I was questioning this government on the property tax issue. Every single day. I probably asked 60, 70 questions. Zero answers. We have gotten to this stage because of forcing the government, and with the courageous, you know, information that came that basically said this whole system was caused by the Premier's office. We have been driving this issue now for over a month, and to the point where we have gotten, you know, the kind of information coming in now from individuals. We've set up a Dropbox to get information. We've set up a website. We want people's information regardless of how many people were affected, what the level of their assessments, information that could come forward about what we see happening in government that needs to change. Arlene, I'm not sure what else I can do, but I completely agree with you. We are trying our best to hold this government accountable, because what we see here is an absolute misuse of power. We've seen a decision made at a senior level, and that senior level would seem to be in the Premier's office, the Premier himself, and we are not getting a square answer coming out of that office. We're getting deflection that's only been changed as we continue to get information dripped out to us. We certainly haven't had an admission like we should have about the ownership that should be taken in the Premier's office, not Service New Brunswick. I completely agree with you. This is not a problem with the individuals and the workers, employees that are in the assessment office working in Service New Brunswick.
Well, I, for one, commend you for everything you've done, and I think the people of this province need to stand behind you to make sure that they support you as an individual who's standing up to do what needs to be done for this province. I've traveled around the country for the last 3.5 years, just finally back to New Brunswick to reside here in my home province, and I can't believe the stuff that's going on here. I mean, this is ridiculous. It's a travesty. People are, you know, basically fighting to keep...
What happened? Arlene, sorry if we lost you, if you're still watching, but thank you very much for your comments. I missed what you said there at the end.
How can anyone expect, with what's going on in the province and the fact that the province is broke, how can anyone expect people to actually stay in this province, reside here, and to earn a decent living to be able to bring up their families here with the kind of stuff that's going on? This is absolutely a travesty.
Arlene, I agree completely with you. That's why we're trying to hold the Premier, take responsibility, take ownership. This tax and spend philosophy is really hurting our province. And I, you know, I'm doing this at this point in my life because I've been in the system. I see how much better we can be, but these political games have to stop.
Now, To assess on that, could you expand on some of the concerns that Arlene was having?
Well, I mean, I think what she's talking about, we're the highest tax province in the country. You know, we've put the HST on saying, oh, we need it to help balance the books, and meanwhile, our spending's gone up $900 million. Our deficit now is is running about $200 million, so we've increased taxes by $700 million. So all we're doing is trying to keep up with spending of this government by taxing people more. And here this program was supposedly worth another $6 million, I think, 5.7, and so they wanted to fast-track it because they need more money in the system to spend. You know, the sad part for me is I know firsthand how good we can be in healthcare. I know how good we can be in education if we let the teachers design the curriculum. We just, as politicians, all we want to know is what does an educated student look like when they graduate. I don't want to get in the classroom. Politicians have been playing in the classroom for years.
Okay. We have to go to break now. Continue with us on Voice of the Province as we continue to talk about property tax assessments in New Brunswick. Hello and welcome back to Voice of the Province. I'm your host, Troy Glover. Today we're talking with Blaine Higgs, the leader of the opposition of New Brunswick. Today we're talking about property tax assessments in the province. But first we're going to go right to the lines because we have John from Moncton waiting. Hello, John.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening, John.
Mr. Higgs, it's a pleasure to talk to you one more time.
All right.
I have some questions.
Sure.
Number one, in most sports events, no matter what, they always say three strikes, you're out. Well, okay, number one, we got the tax mess, and it's a mess. Number two, we got the ACAN deal, and if we ever get to the bottom of it, that's a mess. Number three, we got the bad water in Shediac. That's being talked about, hidden and so on. That's a mess. I don't know where the end is. Now, I'm just questioning, they're saying about they didn't know about this tax problem. Well, it's funny. Every time I get my tax bill, and I go over it fairly thoroughly, at the bottom of it, there's a little form you can tear off, request for review of assessment. This year, I also received in my own another one. Now, why would they send me two unless they were thinking you had a reason you want to make a reassessment request, and then they wanted to know everything you've done to your property and if you shingled it and paved it and done this and that and the other thing? Like, it just looks like it's a little bit shaky, and I just don't understand. Now, question number two. What is the difference between a department and a Crown Corporation? They're all the same thing, aren't they? They have MLAs that are ministers of these Crown Corporations.
Well,
and I just don't understand why they're saying, oh, Crown Corporation is going to be different. What's going to be the difference? I worked for the government for 14 years. And the only thing I remember being a Crown Corporation was the Liquor Commission, and they're doing pretty good. But if it was still a government operation, it would still do pretty good anyhow.
Well, you're right, John. In the case of the Crown Corporations are supposed to be, you know, more independently run, and like NB Powers, you mentioned the NB Liquor. And when Service of Brunswick was made a Crown Corporation, then it has a board of directors, and basically it's supposed to run at arm's length to the government. But what we've seen here is that your point's valid. You worked in government, you know how it can work. Politicians can have influence over Crown Corporations, and they certainly do. So the premier's now taking a position, well, we'll privatize the assessment office and that'll fix it. Well, no, the fix is that the premier's office should not be making decisions, business decisions, that are going to impact so many residents, and now it could be up to 100,000 that are negatively impacted by these fraudulent tax
No, because
bills.
You can't fix something, you're telling them how to run it. You can't fix it, because you're telling them how you want them to run it.
That's right.
If it runs into a problem, now all of a sudden it's their problem. That's crazy.
Yes, it is. And not taking order. That's why for us, John, it's a real scandal, because this issue has been covered up now for over a month, despite repeated questions in the legislature. And I said to a previous caller, I probably asked over 60 questions with zero answers. All it was a deflection and a long tirade, a personal assault in some cases, but no answers. But all the while, the premier and the ministers, they knew what the problem was. All they had to do was come clean and say, look, we've had difficulty here. We tried to roll an automated system. We tried to do it too quickly, so we're going back to our old assessments, and we'll get this up right, and we'll fix it properly. But no, instead, we ignore the truth until the leak comes out, so the actual information is provided. And then what it is, you know, we blame somebody in the civil service.
Well, Mr. Higgs, I understand. understand him as making a statement, or one of his ministers or somebody saying, well, yeah, but the PCs did this 4 years ago. Okay, if they knew that, then why didn't they fix it when they got in power instead of waiting 2 years later?
No, no, there's no comparison to anything that was done in the past, John. That's another deflection.
That.
We call them squirrels, actually. And you see a lot of them in the media. You see a lot of little headliners come out, and it'll be just something to deflect the issue of the day.
Yep.
and make it go away. Well, this one is not going away.
Okay. Now, to backtrack to the property tax assessments, to go more in depth with them, do you think the confidence in New Brunswickers is completely lost when it comes to the accuracy of these assessments now?
Well, I mean, they have reason to certainly question it. There's no doubt. But what I feel and I talked earlier, what I feel the worst about are the individuals that will go out and meet the property owners face to face. The individuals that have had it's not their fault. They're in the system, but yet they're the ones that are going to bear the brunt of a property owner's wrath. And so the property owner is real upset for good reason. And the assessment officer is just trying to figure out the reality of the property. So we've created this animosity, and the people that are going to bear the brunt are the civil servants. And what bothers me is that rather than take ownership for that, rather than stand up and be the leader and be accountable, we perpetuate the scandal of trying to deceive and trying to not talk about it. And my concern is that is not leadership. That's not accountability. How many times have we heard this government talk about accountability, transparency? Oh, we're going to really, be accountable to New Brunswick. We're doing what New Brunswickers say. We're investing in New Brunswick. You know, they're investing tax dollars, but they're not getting any return for the investment. They're saying they're accountable, but there's no signs of that. Talk is cheap. The only time you get any real change is when people do what they say and they act accordingly, and people can see it, not just hear it, because that's all we've seen is talk.
What would you say it would take to regain New Brunswickers' confidence in property tax assessments?
An election.
An election. Okay. with this new team that's going to be looking at the assessments, do you think they can be truly independent?
No, I don't. Because it depends on the mandate that's given, and it's an internal process. So, you know, you need to have an independent view. I suggested that several reporters go in and meet with Service New Brunswick. You want to have a real analysis of what happened? Because this isn't a long, drawn-out, 100-page document. I mean, I was in operations for years and years. And, you know, when we had a problem with either rolling out a new technology or some a new program or a new process, and if it wasn't quite working right, you know, you could spend a day with the team and you put together and you say, okay, what really happened here? Where do we go off the track? Where do we go off the rails? Well, we already know it went off the rails by trying to do something in 1 year or 9 months when it should have taken four. Well, there was the key problem. That should never have happened, because when you do that, you cannot do the quality checks and you cannot insure. So in an effort to get the money in the coffers, in an effort to push this through, and I say again, you know, we've asked the Premier on repeated occasions who made the decision. And he has never come clean on who made the decision. The situation in relation to how do we fix this, go back to 2016, stop the buses, go back to 2016 assessments, and then let everything get back to normal, and then work through the issues that are internally. Did anyone profit from doing a fast track? I've asked that question, because were there incentives being paid to someone to get this out quickly? I mean, was it purely a tax more to spend more in 2017? So there are so many questions that are real clear, but do you think a commission is going to, that monitored internally, is going to come up with those answers? And it'll take 3 months, 4 months, 5 months? This could be done in an afternoon. Could be done in, if we started this next week, without doubt, there could be an answer by the end of the week. But I would say it could be, you could know within a day.
So do you say for a government to simply opt to freeze 2016 tax assessments and get boots on the ground for 2018, would you say that's simple, or would you say that's a bit more complex than that?
No, actually, to go back to 2016 assessment, simple, really. There's no, you've already got that data. So yes, there may have been some property changes in that time, and maybe you know about some of them. But basically, if you start there, then you correct the anxiety that you've placed on all of these property owners that are in the province, that are worried about where their assessment. Did I get my PO? What's happened? So you correct that immediately. So take that anxiety off the table. Tell the service in Brunswick folks, don't worry about your job. We want your help to fix this. We're not trying to lay blame or find fault. We want people to come forward and take ownership for doing a good job, because that's what we need in this province. And then go back to the four-year plan. What is a project plan has all kinds of steps of where you implement different stages, and you check and balance all along the way so you get it right. It's not difficult, but we're making it difficult because we want to deflect the accountability out of the Premier's office.
Now, would you say with this situation there's an opening for individuals to pursue legal action against the governments for what's happened?
There certainly could be. There absolutely could be. I'm not going to comment whether that's a possibility or not, but is there has there been fraudulent activity? Very possibly, and I guess that's up for the RCMP to look at. Because it is certainly a possibility.
Do you think that there should be a public inquiry into this?
I think there has to be an independent process. I hesitate on the public inquiry only because I feel it's over-motoring the situation. This can be solved much easier if you can get an independent review. But if you can't, and taking a position that the commission and this what they've set up will not be, and because it can't be, then maybe that's the only avenue. I just think it has to be independent, and there are other ways to get that than going through all of this public inquiry process, because the problem will not be difficult to determine.
Would you say the effect of what's happened here, would you say it would completely undercut the legitimacy of whatever the government says from now on?
Well, I think they've undercut themselves in many ways right from the get-go. But this has been the straw that will have broken the camel's back. This is the one that finally people should look at and say, wow, every time this government comes out and says, I'm going to build you a new bridge, or I'm going to put money into this, the people should be saying, okay, you're going to put money. What am I getting out of that again? Is our education improving by the? Well, no, we're just going to put more money into it. Is our health services improving? Well, no, but we're going to put more money into it. So my point is, people should realize every time this government promises to spend your money, you should see it exactly as coming out of your wallet, because that is where it's coming from in unprecedented levels. And we have a problem in this province, and the only people that don't seem to understand it is this government.
All right. On the line, we have Albert from Moncton. Hello, Albert.
Hi, how are you?
Good.
Good. I was reading in the newspaper, I think it was yesterday, that the Liberal government is going to be footing the bill for birth control pills at $300 a shot, $300 every time you use it, and it's going to be free. Now, why is this? We have to foot that bill, us the taxpayers, and yet we our electricity goes up every year by 2%, property tax goes up every year by 2% because we don't have money, and yet you have money from our tax dollars to pay for birth control pills at $300 a shot. Can anybody tell me if I'm correct here?
You are correct, Albert. That is something the government just announced. I would say the announcement is, and they don't even know when they're going to do this or in what stage, but it was another one of those things I mentioned a little earlier about throwing stuff out there, hoping to deflect from this whole property tax issue. So, yes, they did announce it. The Minister Boudreau put that out. I don't know how it's actually going to work, the details. We haven't seen all the details. But I would say the timing was related purely to try to deflect the news cycle away from the property tax issue.
Yeah, well, according to the article I read, and I don't want to go on all night with this particular issue, but it was very clear to me that it was $300 per use, and it was going to be supplied free. So that means you and I are going to have to pay for this.
And that's what I understand as well, Albert.
Yeah, well, I think it's time for a change in government.
Well, I do not disagree with that.
I don't believe that just because you're elected for 3 years or 4 years that it's a must that you remain there for that term.
Well,
if you're doing a bad job, we should have thousands of people on the front steps here in Fredericton demanding a change.
Well, Albert, we should. And I guess this scandal that has been that has surfaced over this last month kind of puts that in perspective, that if this continues and this sort of behavior continues in this province, we can't expect to get better results. It just will not happen.
Okay, thank you, Albert, for that call. to kind of take a little bit of a break from property taxes for a second, I'd like to get a bit into Parley Beach, actually. Why do you think it took so long for the government to use federal regulations on water quality instead of provincial ones enacted in 2001?
You know, Tori, it's a good question. There's a lot of questions surrounding Parley Beach and the activity, and of course tied up amongst it all would be the interest of the Minister of Health in the project there for the Cambrian. So I think that looking over the history of water quality and testing and developing a model that is right, that is a major asset for this province, Parley Beach, major tourist attraction. And we need to devote our attention to making sure we fix whatever problem is there. What has clouded the issue has been the conflict, a conflict that was perceived for some time between the minister's interests and his riding being in that riding, and the ownership of a potential mega campground. So that has clouded the whole issue around Parley Beach. But the timing of accepting the different standards. I don't know why that has taken that long. I can't answer that. But I think that we should have the highest quality standards on that beach. It is such an important asset to us in this province.
Why do you feel the tourism minister was so intent for a while to block the release of emails requested by the CBC News?
It's interesting that, then they corrected that there was a question to be asked differently, I guess. But there's another example of what we have seen about what kind of spin are we putting out on this topic, and do we really have to answer that question, or can we deflect it in some other way? And I think at the end of the day, it all came out, but the sensitivity was around, can we say this, or can we find a reason not to say it? And of course, we've seen the Minister of Health, recluse himself from the actual discussion anymore in this area. Well, it's pretty easy to just, once again, walk away from responsibility and say, I don't need to talk about that.
Okay. Well, Mr. Higgs, I'd like to thank you for coming and talking with us tonight.
You're welcome.
Thank you, everyone, for watching tonight for Voice of the Province. I'm your host, Troy Glover. Tonight we were talking about property tax assessments in New Brunswick. I'd like to say to everyone to have a great night and have a great weekend.